If you would please turn back to Psalm 23, which we read together. I swear we are going to have our main focus, and then the thanksgiving of God the Gospel of Matthew, Psalm 22. If you are the writer, the newspaper article, and you want to have a heading, that Psalm is the Lord, my shepherd, and my host. There in this best-known and best Bible of all Psalms, two actually graphic pictures of the individual in their relationship to God and one of his people. The first is the shepherd and the sheep. That's the first picture you get, God as shepherd and the sheep, and then the second, the host and his guest. So verses 1 to 4 talk about God indeed being our shepherd. Indeed, it was natural for a pastoral community to think of the Lord as their shepherd, who led them forth, his people like sheep, and guided them in the wilderness like a flock, which gave them Psalm 78 and Psalm 80 and Isaiah 40. But here, the metaphor actually is made unmistakably possible. It's not just a group of people, but the individual relationship with God. The Lord is my shepherd, the writer boldly claims. And as it even actually mentioned, they are the sheep of the flock. It is quite important in our Christian walk with Christ that our relationship with him should always come first. As many people are bothered about other people's Christian life, and they spend more time more bothered about them than actually our relationship with Jesus. You've got to get those right. And in the end, don't care now about getting up to it. The Christian cannot read or sing this psalm and not think of Jesus Christ, who dared to reapply the metaphor of God to himself. It is he who is to us the good shepherd, the chief shepherd, and the best shepherd of the sheep, John 10, and in 1 Peter 5 and Hebrews 13. Once I can say from personal experience, the Lord is my shepherd, I can add with the assurance the consequence of him being my shepherd. Therefore, can I lack nothing? If the Lord is your shepherd, you surely can lack nothing. The good shepherd cares for his sheep and provides for all their needs. He makes them lie down in green pastures to satisfy their hunger. Leads them beside refreshing waters to quench their thirst, in verse 2. For his name's sake, that is, out of loyalty to his character, and promises he will bring me forth in the path of righteousness. That is, he will not allow me to go astray. You get that in verse 3. I mean, you really realize that. For his own character's sake, he is going to bring you into paradise. He will not allow you to go astray. There have been moments when sometimes I felt I wandered away from the Lord, only to be surprised he was always there. The problem is not that I left the Lord somewhere. It's me who had lost sight that actually he was all around. Indeed, when I walk through the darkest valley, whether it be death or some place, I have nothing to fear. I have no fear because my shepherd is with me, protecting me, guiding me. That's all. So, in the end, my security lies not in my environment, whether green pastures, waters, or right paths, or darkest valley, but in my shepherd. In his presence, there is neither want, plus one, nor fear. Friends, we need to remind ourselves constantly that our security does not lie in anything else except in Jesus. And in verses 5 and 6, we see the Lord as our host. Here the scene actually changes. I'm no longer out of doors, but indoors. No longer a sheep in the flock, get an abundance. My divine hosts have prepared a table before me. It is not a secret feast, but enjoying the presence of my enemies, because when he satisfies my soul, it cannot be hidden from the world. Isn't that amazing? He's prepared a table in front of all my enemies. You know, everybody will see this great host actually feeding me. I was told that there's going to be a sort of a get together after this service. I hope it'll be up to standard. Because the table is prepared. See, what Jesus does for us, he wants us to watch for him. His provision, his wonderful lavish, a table laden with food, a thick walls from my head, and an overflowing basket. Moreover, what God has begun, he will surely continue, as he himself would lead me forth. That was in verse 2 to 3. So his long-life kindness and mercy shall follow me. Thus he will guide me, behind me and before me, all the days of my life. This shepherd, who is before, around, throughout all our days of our life, because he cares. And what Dickens said about Walker, who cared so much about their clients, Dickens said, you know, this particular social worker cared so much about the clients, you knew who they were by the happy look on their faces. Now, that's not what our shepherds do. I mean, we're not hunted. We're simply protected, guided, and led forth. Therefore, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Not indeed in the tabernacle or the temple, not even just in his presence in this life, but in my Father's house with its many mansions, in which Jesus spoke, and in which actually he said he had gone to prepare a place for his own. In my Father's house are many resting places. So not only are we dwelling in Jesus in this life, we also want to discover how we go through death, the gate of eternal life, already he's there waiting for us. And then we're dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. And by the way, I hope you enjoy worship now. Because if you're not, heaven will be hell for you. Because the only occupation in heaven is worship. There's nothing else. So I hope we'll show the Lord that we have an expectation of heaven. The psalmist anticipates the day when in the town of heaven held, with many resting places, all shall be well and all manner of things shall be well. You see, I'm looking forward to two things. Either Christ coming in my lifetime again, or when I've died and gone on to be with him. And in either case, I do rejoice because right now I am in his presence. Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die. So he who has been the dwelling place of his people in all generations, kept by his power and their lives in Christ, in the bosom of God, Colossians 3:3, he shall bring them all into the fold to enjoy the rest which remains to all people of God. We will be brought into that amazing place where God's will is done. In the meantime, as we await our Lord's return, we actually rejoice in the glory of our Lord's promise. Promise which were in his last words to the disciples when he had their last meeting. Paul for us in Matthew 28, verses 16 to end. When we read those verses, we will see what the Lord is promising. He promised them glory. Secondly, assured them of his power. The power which shall conquer death is the same power that he gives to you and to me. Now, not in the future. That same power that enabled Christ from death to life is the same power he actually has. Secondly, he gave them a commission to make all the world his disciples. Not selecting other people. But he gave them a commission. Go and make disciples of all nations. You and I have a job, and you here in Saltburn, to go out and make sure you make the whole of Saltburn God's people. And you reminded me of a visit when I came here. We were on the promenade down there, and there was a lot of wind, and it was pretty cold, but it was quite interesting. Four people came to know Christ and prayed prayers of commitment in the midst of other people. Someone here, Bishop, you too have a job to share the good news of Jesus with your friends and tell them that there is a shepherd and a host who is inviting them that they should become his friends. So he assured them of his power, he gave them a commission, and then thirdly, he promised them his presence, the greatest presence in the world. Lo and behold, I am with you till the end of time. When time has been rolled into eternity, we shall find ourselves. The presence of Jesus now is the very presence in which we will be walking into. So the Lord is our shepherd. He cares, guards, and leads us. He's also our host. He feeds, he refreshes, and enables us to nestle under the shadow of wing like a hen gathers around her young. All we can do not in the end say, praise the Lord. He's our shepherd. Caring, guarding, leading us. He's our host. Feeding us, refreshing us. And then gathers us under the shadow of his wing. So we're worthy friends, that we say. And for those who live in the church, I'm sure that's what's their intention. The people who come here will discover the power of Christ, will be part of his greatest mission. We'll also experience his presence. In fact, when we come into church, we should go away different from when we first came. Yes, we come with Christ, he's with us, but when we gather as his body, we ought to somehow be there. When have we met each other, we met the Lord in a new way. So may I encourage you, if you've got the same task, like those we gathered here 150 years ago, to know Christ's presence, to know his power, and to carry out his mission, which sent him from the Father because of his love, to make Christ's friend. And that's why it's important, actually, to learn to get on with each other, because in the world to come, the very people you're finding very different.